In this video, we make another excursion into reversing C programs. To be specific, we will talk about the Global Offset Table, short GOT, and the Process Linkage Table, short PLT. Let's start by creating a very simple C program that just calls a couple of libc functions. So I just write two printfs and an exit. These two functions are clearly external functions, I haven't defined them myself, and they come from libc. When I compile this binary with GCC, libc will be dynamically linked to this binary, which means that libc is not included in the program. With LDD, we can see the dynamic libraries referenced from this binary, and it shows that it wants libc, and it also displays the path on my system where my libc binary is. This is great because then the program can be much smaller, and libc can receive updates without having to recompile my binary. But this also means that the addresses in libc might be different for each version. So how can I compile a binary to assembler when I have to know the exact address so I can create a call instruction? Well, this is where the PLT and GOT comes into play. Let's open this binary in Hopper disassembler and let's have a look at the main function. So first thing we notice is, where the hell are our printfs? Why are there puts calls? Well, the assembler saw that we specified a constant string, not a dynamic format string, thus decided to replace the printf with puts. But anyway, we have here our three function calls, and Hopper decided to prefix the name of the call location with a J, probably for jump, not sure. So if we follow this call, we notice that we don't end up in libc puts. We are still in our binary. Also, how would we? Because libc is not included in this binary. We landed in the PLT section, the process linkage table, and the call to this here is immediately followed up with a jump to an address stored at another location. And this location got the name puts at GOT. So let's go there. Now we are in a segment called GOT, the global offset table, and the jump will jump to whatever address is stored here. And at the moment, the address that is stored here is referencing an external symbol. So what are they doing here? During compilation, we don't know the address of puts or exit. So we just create a function trampoline. We call a location we know where it is, the PLT section, which contains a jump with the jump location referenced from this list or table if you want. So all we have to do to be able to use external functions from a library is somehow write the real address of libc function in this table. And this is what's happening when we execute the binary. As you know by now, an ELF binary is not just a plain assembler code. Before our code gets executed, the complicated ELF file format is parsed, and based on that, the process is set up by the kernel. And during that time, references like that might get resolved. So let's debug this binary. Let's just use Hopper this time. First, we set a breakpoint in main by clicking the red column on the left here. Then we open the debug interface with the button on the top right. So let's step forward until we follow the call to puts. As expected, we arrive in the PLT section and are just about to jump to the address referenced in the global offset table. Let's step further and let's see what happens. Oh, nope. We don't go to puts in libc. Somehow we ended up right after the jump and a push value now on the stack. As you can see, every PLT entry, we have this push of a number and then a jump to this address up here. And when we follow this jump, we end up in a function called DL runtime resolve. We can use the proc file system to have a look at the memory maps of this process, and we can see that the address from DL runtime resolve belongs to this LDSO binary. The main page for LDSO tells us that this is the dynamic linker or loader. So this library helps us to set up the external references to libc. This function does magic, no idea what it does in detail, but it will find the address of the puts function in libc and updates the global offset table, and also execute puts. Now the second time we want to execute puts, the GOT got updated and we will jump to the address stored in the global offset table, and we directly jump to puts from libc. This global offset table is very useful when writing exploits, because there are a couple of things you can do with it. For instance, we have an arbitrary write. We can write a value wherever we want, anywhere in memory. So you can simply overwrite the address in the global offset table for a certain function. And the next time this function is called, the code will be redirected to whatever you entered in the table. Let's say you have a memory leak, for example, through a format string exploit, like from the previous video, and the binary doesn't use ASLR. Well, the system itself can still have ASLR enabled, thus the location of libc will always be random. But the addresses of the global offset table in our binary is always fixed. So when you can read from an address you control, you can read an entry of the global offset table, which is an address in libc, which you can then use to calculate the offsets to other locations of libc, which is useful if you have to find ROP gadgets or you want to do a return to libc attack. Sometimes you even have a buffer overflow on arbitrary write in a function, but the function itself never returns because it calls exit or loops forever. Thus, overriding the return pointer on the stack doesn't help to redirect code execution. That's exactly the challenge in this format level 4 of exploitexercise.com. We cannot overwrite the return address on the stack because we'll never return. Well, we can overwrite it, but we will never return and we can thus never redirect code execution. So we have to rely on a different technique to gain control over the program execution. See you next time when we use a format string vulnerability to overwrite an entry on the global offset table to redirect code execution.